Welcome to this free webinar on how can you make a resume that is very effective in the current software industry market, right? So it's got a lot of slides, a few slides, but some of the slides have rich content. Let me quickly walk through those. I will take about 45 minutes or so to walk through the slides and the content and the message that I want to pass. After which you can start to put your questions over the chat and I'll be glad to answer some of them. I will also be recording this session and I'll post it on the YouTube channel and send across the link so that you can watch offline as well. Alright, so let's get started. So here is what you will see in this presentation. I talk a lot about what kind of a keywords do you put inside your resume, what kind of a header should you try and put into your resume. How should your summary skills look and how should your project details look? So that is basically the construction of your resume. Now, if you've been someone who's participated in some of the training programs that I've organized on QTP and Selenium so far, how do we take that expertise and that talent that you've developed and put that very strongly in your resume? Because it is not a live project, it is not something that you've got paid to work with, but still, you've built your expertise while practicing, while seeing my videos and so on. And how do we put that into place? We'll come towards the end. So the first section is called as keywords. What are keywords? Keywords are basically, how does a recruiter search for your resume among thousands of them that are there on a job portal like a Monster or a Dice or a CareerBuilder.com and so on? How do they do it? The way they do it is they search for, let's say, a QTP descriptive programming framework. Those are the keywords that you use to search. Now then, who will come up first? The people who have recently updated the resumes, but with lots of keywords, with saying QTP or saying descriptive programming or saying automation framework presented. So number one, you have to make sure that you identify the keywords, all right? Once you identify the keywords, then you can go about putting them into the resume. So what is identifying the keyword? So I've got two examples. One is a bad example, one is a better example. And team, whatever you see here are my views, my thoughts that I've collected over years of exposure to the industry. And you know, this is what I feel and I recommend. So that's your choice on how you wanna take it and implement it. So for example, we talked about Selenium as a test automation tool. So I see a lot of resumes. I've been trying to recruit someone and unfortunately I see people who have talent, who have exposed to concepts like remote control or web driver or grid with Java, but they've been shy to put it there. What happens is on the resume, I don't see anything. Accidentally, I talk to them and then I happen to see that, hey, you've got good knowledge. Why are you not putting them in the resume? Right? So what happens is if you've got the skill set, you've got to put it in there. If you've got the talent. For example, what does the bad part say? I have keywords like Selenium, testing, ID, record and run and so on. Why is testing bad? Instead of testing, use automation testing using Selenium. Instead of just IDE, say Selenium IDE. Do not use things like record and run too much. I mean, they cannot say that, recruiters will not search saying that, hey, I do not want people who've got record and run in the resume. They cannot do a search like that. But what they can do is, it doesn't make sense. It doesn't really qualify you. So number one, your keywords should have specific words. Like Selenium IDE is one keyword. Selenium is one keyword. Selenium testing, Selenium RC. Again, I have Selenium remote control. Why? Because someone is searching for Selenium RC, but there's someone else who's searching for Selenium remote control. And if you just put remote control, you will not be in preference compared to someone who's put a Selenium remote control in your resume. And this is all for the search engine optimization concept. Typically, when you do web search, similar thing when you do a resume search on this job portal. All right? Make sure you list these keywords down first. They will help your resume to become search friendly. You have to also repeat. Just because you use Selenium WebDriver in a specific portion on one project, don't think that why should I put it again in another project. When you have more than one time repeating some of these keywords, your strength increases. What is the intent? The intent is to get you into the top of the searches. Another tip that is not mentioned in your team is, if you're active in the market and you constantly go to the job market and update it, your resumes will come first. Why? That is how these job portals have been. Why? Because when recruiters are searching, if they find resumes which have been posted 6 months ago and there's been no activity on that, that candidate may not be available, right? So the search engine within these job portals have been developed over a period of time. They've got smarter, and they said the people who have very recently updated their resumes on the portal, on the job site, will be highly preferred. And that's what you should focus on. Now, there are sometimes tools which you have only an idea about, but you've not really mastered. That's fine. You know something about it. Put it in there. Do not just take it out. What I'm saying is, your resume should contain all the things that you've worked on. Okay? Because you do not know what someone is searching for. And that will help you come up in the front of the search. So this is about keywords. Once you develop the keywords, you can take each of them and make sure they're appearing in different portions in your resume. All right? That is to find you. Now, once someone finds your resume, then what? The first thing that typically comes out is kind of a header. And here is a sample thing. A header can be as simple as my name, my email address, and my contact number. Right? That's fine. It's standard. There's nothing wrong with this. But what happens is, if you see that you put a LinkedIn logo and you put your LinkedIn profile in there, what does that mean? Number one, logos or images in a resume attract a viewer to it. Okay, that's number one. Second, it says that this person is networking, has got connections, is willing to share his or her social profile with them in a way that it can look more realistic. So if you've got about 5-6 projects that you've really worked on and you have a LinkedIn profile, put it in there. If you're someone, I don't personally believe too much in certifications, but I know a lot of people in the industry still do it. So if you've been certified by BrainBench or ISTQB and so on, or HP, just put those logos saying that you're certified and put the logos in there as images. Okay. Also try and insert a title. What are you? Are you an automation expert? Or experienced test professional, or somewhere who's been in the software testing industry for a while, think about something catchy, two or three words under your name. What that tells you is you think greatly and you're proud of what you do, right? That's an impactful header to start. Where does this come? This comes as part of your header section in your resume. That's what you put in the top, okay? You know, there are fancier things like Google Voice. Does it really matter? Is Google Voice a big hit? No, it's not. But what happens is when you do something different from the normal, people get attentive on it and they look at it. Team, I hope at this point, just take a quick break to see if everyone is able to hear me okay. All right, cool. So let's continue with where we left. So this Google Voice is just like a, you know, something different. Let me stand out. If I have a Google Voice number, why don't I put it there? It says that someone is trendy, someone is following the trends and trying to use the latest technology and so on. All right? So that's about a resume header. Not a big impact, but something that you look at. It's like the first impression that you make. When someone opens it, it's the header that comes out. The next section is a resume summary. So I've just collected different types of summaries that I've seen over the past few things and put that as a collage out. Now, what's bad in this to look at a resume summary? If I have to interview someone, do you think, number one, I will read every word of a 5-page resume? No, I will not. What is a summary? Summary is a short version of your overall career and so on. So it should be little shorter. Second thing is that you should focus on keywords which are very strong. It should create impact. For example, this I'm not going to read through it, but just to show you how it's looking. If I show you the good part of it, here is another summary. The same message that was conveyed in about 25 lines or 30 lines out here, whatever, I have have tried to put it in under 10 lines. And I structured it in a way that it is one line each. It does not go into multiple lines. It is easy on the eyes for someone to look at. It is easy for someone to think that, okay, summary is short. Probably if I read every word in the summary, I'll get an overview. That's number two. Third thing is, when they read it, you have to highlight the main keywords. Let's say you're someone who's been strong in automation. You've been someone strong in manual testing or database and web service testing, or even cross-browser mobile testing or device testing and so on. Put those there. Okay. Just saying I've been in the industry, software industry for 7 years, worked in large projects, small projects. Who's going to read all that? They want to look at where's the punch. Now look at this. Plan, design, build and maintain complex test automation frameworks to follow your first sentence. And then you mention what type of frameworks. Then you mention that I'm expert on two tools. One is Selenium, one is HTTP. And then you say using WebDriver and server, heavy programming using Java, JVM and test engine. Message passed. Why do I have to split this into 5 lines about Selenium? 1 line, good. Second, similarly on Qtp. What am I good at? VBScript and descriptive programming. I talked about frameworks. I talked about both the tools. I talked about the scripting. And I also talked about what we use in it. That's it. The other one, if you look at, is now talking about your organizational skills, your team skills, and your ability to interact and so on. We're talking about you being a hands-on team leader. Why do I use the word hands-on team leader? If you have put your resume as a QA analyst or a QA lead, and you're looking to continue in the lead position or growing into becoming a team lead, then you would see that there are a lot of requirements for team leads. But a lot of challenges have happened when team leads just continue to do coordination in the projects and not real hands-on experience. And when someone reads that as a first word, saying that hands-on team leader, what does that mean? It means someone who's ready to do the work, who's ready to coordinate, who's ready to get into testing, but will also do the coordination and lead a set of people onshore, offshore, remotely, and so on. That message is critical. Okay? If you are in that capacity, you should use those. And look at this, amazing team player. What is amazing team player? I'm a very good team player. What has got very good team player? Everyone will put, I'm a very good team player. If you put amazing team player, you're trying to convey a message that people are amazed to work with you. They like to work with you. You're a very easy and a friendly person to interact with. Okay? And then finally, I talked about different kind of environments that you work. You've worked in Agile, you've worked in Scrum, you've worked in complex, dynamic, onshore, offshore, and so on. That's about it. That's your summary. Summary should be crisp. It should be neat. It should be crystal clear about what your core capacity. That's your resume summary. Now, let's move on to the next slide. Okay, now here comes the skill summary. Typically what you see is an education section or a skill summary following this. What is a skill summary? That tells at a high level what are the skills or technologies or tools or programming languages that you've got good hands-on or you've got good exposure to. Why do I say this is bad? Is it because of the format or the background? No. We typically do not use any background colors in Word document, but that is not the intent of putting this there. The intent of putting this there is that you put everything that you know into one section. So if basically you get someone interviewing you, and let's say he or she is an expert on Unix platform and gets into the details of Unix level discussions, then what will happen is your strength is on Selenium, or your strength is on a Bugzilla or a Jira tool, or on QTP, but the discussion has got diverted onto Unix, because that is what you've shown there, and that is what the interviewer has an interest in. And then the whole 1 hour, 15 minutes, you're just wasting time trying to explain something that you're not strong on. So the idea is distribute your skills as core skills, and then exposure skills. You can put it as strong usage or exposure kind of a word. Why do I say core skills? When you put core skills, you say, these are the things that I'm really master at. When I say strong usage or exposure, I'm saying that I know these tools. I'm not master at it, but I've been exposed to it and I can build my knowledge on it. Divide them in that category. And this should be a truth statement, because if you do not show and divide them into something that you're really strong on, and something that you're well aware of, then you're distributing the whole discussion across the system. Alright? Now, let's look at the next topic. Projects. Very critical. I don't necessarily see an issue in this way of representing a project. I do not see. And you can also highlight differently. But all I'm trying to say is that when you do such level of information you put it into a project, what happens, number one, it is so distributed. It's got so much stuff into it. The client name is somewhere, the application details are somewhere, what your role is somewhere, and so on. You should try and structure it into a little more organized fashion, right? Try and not go overboarded on projects in terms of size. Now, if you look at this and you look at the next portion of the same thing, I have not changed it significantly, okay? All I did is I cut down the content. I said who the client is. I said what the project is. I say how big is the team overall and so on. What kind of an environment do you work in and so on. You can also put your role or title as part of it. Then into responsibilities, you have to use specific things to it. Look at what I've highlighted. I didn't highlight sprint, team, and agile in this case. I said dynamic environment. Okay. Typically, you do not see certain words coming up in a resume like amazing or dynamic or powerful and so on. Those are the words people will get attracted to when you highlight. And when there's a dynamic environment, they will continue to read. Look at this, 250 test cases. I said that you've written or maintained or executed 250 test cases, a huge collection of it in Quality Center. That's a great thing to put. People typically say that I've used Quality Center to maintain my test management and test cases and so on. But hey, why don't you put a number to it? Why? Numbers, typically when you look at overall text document, when there are numbers, attention goes to it. So there's more focus on your resume at that point. Alright? Then, different words highlight differently, like smoke test for each week. So, if you want to highlight smoke testing, then you put that. You talked about training, that you've trained users. It doesn't have to be 20 users. Even if you say 5 users, it could be your own team members. You've performed knowledge transition to them. You've walked through the domain, the functionality of the application, and how the QA team works. That's training. Put that in there because that's big. A lot of these environments will require people to be moving around, different projects, coming in new, going out and so on. So there's a lot of discussion, there's a lot of transition of knowledge. So those words should come up typically, okay? And if you look at some of the things like 70 plus QDP scripts to one Selenium diversity. See, this highlights saying that you've got exposure to QDP, you've got exposure to Selenium, you've moved a lot of stuff from QDP to Selenium, you've done the migration, and you're also saying the number. When you put a number, it looks realistic. It looks that, yes, this person has worked on it. Typically, what happens, team, is that when I'm trying to interview, I go with this very suspicious mind, unfortunately, that does this person really have what he or she's mentioning in the resume? So we go with kind of a negative mentality, which is unfortunate. However, when you put certain data into that resume, your credibility increases and we are able to connect with you better when you're doing the interview. Alright? And in this, I've also mentioned mobile testing. You could have involved in a very small portion, but talk about that. If you have done device-based testing or a network-based testing or a WAP-based testing and you've used different parts of iPhone, iPad and so on, put that in there. Do not lose such important stuff. Even if you worked on it for a couple of days, that's fine. Because these are the trends. These, you don't expect someone who's got 10 years of mobile testing experience or 7, 8 years. Someone will typically have 2, 3 years or 4 years at the max kind of a mobile testing experience. And when you put it in there, that means that you've got additional skills in it. So team, any questions so far? And I'm assuming my voice is good. Can you send me a message on the chat if you're all okay so far, please? Alright, good. So I'll continue. We'll come to the questions, which are kind of specific a little later. Alright. Alright, so that's about projects. See, go back to the bad part and look at the good part. It is not the format. I have actually taken out the highlights. Highlights are very important because no one's going to read 200 words. Even even if you look at this, I want someone to go look at dynamic environment, toolkit test cases, smoke test, script-free keyword event automation framework, 45% test cases, WebDriver plus JUnit. That's how I would scan through a resume. Yeah, so that will give more focus to what you want to discuss on. That's the whole intent team. When you go to an interview, it's not about listening and waiting for someone to ask a question and then trying to answer. It is a great idea to get into a discussion, an involved interaction. So it can be, then what will happen is the discussion gets over quickly and you are tending to ask more questions on the project and what your role may be. That's what you want to get to, right? Now, what's the challenge that I've been trying to drive home with this whole crank your resume thing? Number one. Lot of you may not have experience. When I say no experience, I'm not saying that you will not work. I'm not saying that you have not been a manual test engineer of automation. You've probably been into manual testing for, let's say, 5 years or 6 years or 12 years, but really didn't get a chance to work on automation testing. And that's the direction you go. What does that mean? You've got no project experience on it. When you do not have project experience, what happens is your keywords get weak. You do not have the right keywords in your resume. If you don't have the right keywords in your resume, interviewers cannot find you. They cannot get to interview you. And that will lead to, and this happens to me. It's not just you or anyone. It happens to anyone in the industry. And your confidence level can hit a boost and it may not do great for your job search. That's the challenge. All right. Now, what I am going to show next is all about participants who've gone through the training program, who've spent effort and time and would like to take the best use of what has been shown in the program. They've learned so many things to put that to a great use. That's what I'm going to try and show next to you. Now I talk about something called as an off-project experience. What do I mean by project experience? Project experience is something that you were part of a team where you're working for a specific client and you are getting paid to do that job. Typically, that is what you put in your resume. You tend to underplay a lot of other things that you know, but you've never worked. You will say that, no, I didn't put on my resume because I only got trained on it and that's why I didn't want to put. Why do you want to play it low? Play it high. Play it with confidence. And that's what this off-project experience will talk about. The message is very simple. How do you take some things that you've learned and put it into your resume? For example, let me talk about this project one. What is this? I'm saying take this content and put it into your resume. Take what content? As part of either the QTP or Selenium training that I've conducted, where close to about 2,500 participants I've attended worldwide in the last 24 months, team. You have been exposed to fundamentals to a very, very advanced level topic. I'm saying go back to those videos, go back to what you've done in those sessions, pick up those projects, go through, take one project. So typically, it's a project-based approach that I've taken in the training. So take any project, for example, Chase.com that we've used, or the Facebook application, or a LinkedIn application, or different other financial and mortgage related projects that we've taken to execute. Take them and get the summary out of it and put it into such a format. What does the left side say? The left side says that this is an application called Chase.com, and this is a module called Loan Calculator, and use HP QTP 10. Okay, I'm showing you examples of QTP. You can change it to Selenium based on what you want to project. Okay, I have split it into four parts. One is the plan. Then how did we design and build it? Then how did we run and maintain this thing? And how? What kind of the tools and concepts did we use? In the plan, I talk about more like the requirement. The requirement is to create a script to test about a few test cases, about three test cases. For different sets of data. Your test data is in an Excel and you want to execute this, automate it and get the error report back into that Excel. Now, how did we design it? So we picked up data-driven automation framework. Then we said how we read information from Excel into QTP. Then we talked about how do we build a driver script and parameterize the data into VBScript arrays. How do we apply the concepts of descriptive programming, ordinal and defined, and so on. So look at the kind of keywords that I've used. I've not highlighted because almost everything is a key. For example, if you look at one second, AUT, application analytics, web objects, regular expressions, ordinal identifier, shared object repository, QTP function library, application workflow, for loops, condition statement, select case, user-defined environment variables, global data, main test action. Look at the types of keywords that I've used. What does it show? Number one, it shows that you've been exposed to all of these concepts, which you actually have been. And if you practiced on this, watched the videos and practiced on it even one or two times, then great, you've got the skill. Put it in there. Once you put the skill on your resume, what does it do? Number one, keywords. It creates a very search-friendly resume. Second, what does it do? When someone looks at this and says that you have a project section, you start with summary, you start with the skills summary, you put your education, you put your career background, then you explain your live project in detail. Then you have this off-project experience, and then you put three or four projects like this. And someone will be able to say, hey, what are these? Then you say that, you know, I've gone through a training program. I'm not asking you to put my name in there. I'm not asking you to put that you've gone through IT Elearn or QTP Elearn or Selenium. Forget about that credit. Credit yourself for what you've done, okay? Put that in there, and then be surprised to see something like this in there. And then you mention that I've attended this program, I've spent about 6 months or 12 months, close to about a couple of hours every day, enhancing my skills because I didn't get that exposure on the job and I wanted to do it. It shows proactiveness, it shows interest, it also shows the level of detail that has gone, okay? So that creates a good impression. The third thing about the effectiveness of this is someone who's scanning through your resume will be so interested in looking at this, the entire focus might move away from some other project where you've not got significant experience on automation tools and land on this project where you've mentioned everything. And if he or she asks you, hey, what is this honor? How did you apply? Then you can say, you know, for error handling, we start with honor resume next. We have an honor 420. And I use error.error or error.description to identify if an error occurred. What does it say? It says, as soon as you talk those words, someone will say, wow, that's amazing, you've been exposed to it. So how do you interact with Excel? How do you read it? Then you say that you use data table using import sheet, add sheet, and so on. Or you can also say you've used Excel objects using create object method and so on. You are discussing. Now is the time you're talking and they're listening. That is the reason you must have. It is, you do not have to put my name, you do not have to give the credit under my name, forget about it, give it to yourself. You've worked hard for it, do that. Now, this is one project, a different flavor of the same thing, we can put it into another project and say, this is a keyword-driven operation framework. Then create another one for a hybrid framework. Create one more for data-driven. You've been exposed to how many projects as part of each training? At least 5 or 6. And you've got so many videos to access, you've got at least 10-15 projects in total to select from, correct? So you've got so many things to select from, just pick the information and put it into it. Do yourself a favor by doing it, alright? Change the application, change the module. They'll say that not only are you understanding the tool, you're also working on different complex applications. Use keywords in this. It is so SEO friendly in this case. Use numbers, how many test cases, what, and so on. Use the test run and maintenance section, if you look at team, is about when you actually do the executions. How do you manage things? How do you update it? How do you create and maintain them? Because that's also a very important part of it, right? Tool usage, I just mentioned a few of them, but put 25-30 words into it. Repeat them, that's fine. It will only give more power to your resume. talking about things. I was talking about if I go back and do a quick summary of project experience. You're missing the live experience as a project experience. Now let's use the training experience and put that in there. Use this, put project one, put project two, put project three, four, put six projects. What's wrong? Put an 8-page resume. That's fine. What does it say? You have exposure. I would typically love a 1-page resume. I would love to see. There's no question about it. But it may hide all the details. It may not be search friendly. That's fine. You put it. There's nothing wrong in creating it. It only says that this person has something to show, something to talk about. All right? But highlight, make it easier for the person trying to recruit you or interview you to go through resumes and the critical sections. Use highlights. All right? So in the similar fashion, like what you see in project one and project two, put that. But team, be aware of this. Do not put this if you have not watched those projects in detail or if you have not gone through and practiced it at least a little bit. The reason is you will put everything and you'll feel very lame if you don't answer 80% of that, because everything has a concept and you don't want to apply some of the meaning to some of the words. If someone asks you what is a select case statement, you don't want to go and say that it is a condition and we have a very simple, but I don't remember that right now. I've just used it once. You do not. You want to say very confidently that if I have many if loops, if statements, and I've, instead of using nested if statements, which is untidy and can be performance issue, I can use one select case statement to combine everything, where I have one value to verify with multiple, one variable or to verify with multiple values, and then I can use this combined conditional statement using select case. That seems more logical. And then you can say, this is what I used it for, this is what I used it for keywords and so on. Make that something that someone is waiting to hear from. Alright? Do this part and your resume will fly for sure. I do understand there are other things like your work status, your location, your other constraints which will play, but having this will at least get you talking. And that's primarily the output. You will increase your strength of the keywords, you will be creating a much better resume, you may receive more interview calls, and that will also increase your exposure to interviews, your confidence on the interviews, and the focus of the interview may get onto the off-project experience where you've really worked on. All right, team. So now coming to kind of the last slide, and this is the bottom line. The message in this is very simple, that keywords are important. You should focus on your strength and keep it simple, keep it stupid simple. You know the KISS concept? You should keep it in such a way that anyone is able to quickly go through. You don't need to have fancy things or put colors in your resumes. Try, if you want to use images, just use a few of the meaningful images on the header side. Try and keep your focus on your strength. Bring the discussion to places where you have experience. And if your experience through the training is what has given you the confidence, then shift the focus. And that's why I say keep your best foot forward. And as you remember, team, at least people who have participated, I ask everyone as to what is the number one thing that is an output of this session of training. And the answer I expect is the confidence. When you started, you had no clue and you probably had fear if you'll be able to do it. When kept going, you at least have the confidence that I think I can do it. And some of you may have even bigger confidence that this is what I need to put. Now I know, now I'll do it. And that's what is the core thing. Alright, so that's the quick summary. That's the webinar that I wanted to put in. Just remember all these things what I've mentioned. Go back to the video, watch it. We're going to be posting this up on YouTube as well. And feel free to start putting your questions over the chat team so that I can take up and try and get very specific with it and then go on. Let's see. Can we highlight any word with color in summary, any section? I wouldn't advise because colors really don't make any impact. It may sometimes go negative. You can keep it standard. I've just used it, but you can keep it standard. you can probably use underlines if you really want to emphasize on few of the highlighted ones. But the issue will come up is when you take this and paste it into a text format, like a notepad, where a lot of job sites want you to put it. Why do they want you to copy a resume into a text box and put it in there? Because once they put it in there, they're able to make it search friendly. When someone searches, it goes through that input that you put in there to be able to find the right candidate. Any thumb rule on how many projects to mention in resume? So, yeah. So there's no thumb rule here, but typically let's say that, for example, I've got about 15 years in the industry as an experience, okay? I may focus my last two or three assignments or the last four assignments with longer descriptions than the first 5 years. The first 5 years, I'll try and reduce it to about 3 to 5 lines each. Why? Each of the projects exists. Why? Because it has become very irrelevant right now. The only thing that is critical is that where you started, where you worked, and so on. So focus on the most recent. So that way, there's no thumb rule. If you've worked on it, keep it in there. There's nothing wrong in keeping what you've done. Now let's look at it. Will it be a good idea to mention if I have tested on Mac? Absolutely. Why not? So if you've tested your application on a MacBook and on a Windows platform or on other platforms, mention it in there and highlight this. How many people would love to see the word MacBook or an iPhone or an iPod touch or an iPad on your resume? That's trendy. That's nice to see, because when you see those words, immediately your attention goes on. That's a great thought as well. Let's see. It doesn't say anything about the project chase or off project. Yeah. So let's see. Let me go to that section. It doesn't say anything about the project, because what I did in this project thing is I put it in the plan. You can put some more things and mention it there. You can also put as to how you've got this off-project experience. What did you really do? But that you can leave it for discussion. Let them be curious to talk to you. You put every detail in your resume that I've attended this training and this is part of it. The question is already asked. Put it as off-project, off-project experience. And then leave it in there, let them see that and be interested to call you to get the answer. At least they're more inquisitive to get into discussion and talk about it. How to find entry-level job? Everyone asking for experience. So that's what I'm saying. You don't have experience. You don't have project experience, or you don't have even enough years to show something. Then take 8 projects or 10 projects out of the program that we've done, put it in this format and create your resume. And say, this is my off-project experience. Just remember your college days too. Just remember when you were a student and you were trying to come out of the college and get into a job. What do you put there? You put there what was the campus project you did. What was the on-site project you did. Where did you go? What did you develop in your lab? Where did you go to present a paper if you did, right? What did you do then? Did you have a project experience? No. But you showed that you've got the experience to take on the project. And that is the idea. If you've not got the experience, put something. This is a way better than having a resume which just says that, you know, one project with a little bit of details about something, which is not very impactful. But again, team, I'm cautioning that the importance is to ensure that you practice and you work and you watch those videos on the projects that you mentioned. That's very, very important. Okay? Would you share this PPT to us? I will definitely put this PPT into both the QTP and Selenium Google groups. You can pick it up from there. In USA, do we need to have 1 or 2 page resume? No, there's nothing stopping from you having a 5 page resume. Nothing wrong. Okay? You could put a short form of your resume, which is 1 page or 2 page, then you could have a lengthier version. But I would say, try and put everything into 4 or 5 pages. 10 pages is too long, 2 pages is too short for everything. Try and be in the between. Let's see, can you send this user with an email, it'll help. Yeah, so I'll put it into the Google group for sure. Does ISTQB give any weightage to the profile? From my perspective, I would not care too much at all. If I'm interviewing someone, even for a test engineer position, I would not. Yes, it'll increase a little bit credibility that, you know, the person has done this effort and has got himself or herself credited with that certification. But if you look at the industry, there are many members who will give weightage to it because that's what they're looking for. So it is, you cannot take one person's view into strength. I may not, but there may be a lot of other people doing it. So if you've got it or if you're planning to do it, then put it in. So, Subhati, as I told you, if you've got no QA experience, put everything as part of what you've got through the training. All right? Put it there. There's nothing wrong with it. I don't have automation experience, so how can I still make it eye-catching? That's exactly what I'm saying that I've mentioned, that you put this and say that this is my experience. I don't have project experience, unfortunately. I didn't get exposure to it. I'm loving to do it. I've done this. This is my groundwork. You tell me what will make me get this project. That is what you should talk. Imagine this thing, and this is kind of a motherhood statement, but I'll still make it, is that if I go for, let's say, a director level position in a company, okay? If I act, behave, or show a body language like a director level position, then I am in the interviewee place and someone is interviewing. But if I act and behave and show a body language, not arrogance, not overconfident, but pride, but certain level of dignity and a certain level of confidence, that is beyond a director to, let's say, a vice president level. And that's how I project myself. There is a strong impact. So I'm saying stand up, have confidence, walk with a lot of pride and show that this is what I know and this is what I can do. If you're going for a test engineer position, treat yourself like you're a QA lead. If you're going for a QA analyst position, treat yourself like you're going for a QA manager. But still the discussion may get into details, but at least your body language should show that confidence. What I know from management and recruiters that resume should be one page. That's what I told you, Sharif, that I would love to see a one-page resume. Okay. But I'm talking about in a case, I've seen resumes which have been one-page, which have been excellent because they've got the strength in what they've done. If you go back to my first slide where I talked about the summary, right, this is the bad one and this is the good one. If I write a few more things here, two lines per project and finish five projects in this, I will have a one-page resume ready, correct? And these things will help you concise your overall thing into shorter. And I believe with 4 years of experience and you put about 5-6 projects of project experience, like the ones I showed, you can still put the whole thing into about 3.5-4 pages. Can you show a dummy resume that has all this implemented? No, not really, Pavel, because I'm showing you a concept. I'm showing you a thought. I want you to try it out. Every section is different. Okay. I have some of them, but I mean, I'm not sure if I'll be able to show it publicly. These are some. Can an experienced resource add offshore projects? Yes. And I would say you should add offshore project experience. Why? Because what it does is sometimes even if you're okay, here's the thing. I'm looking for a QTP automation engineer, for example. Okay, I interview someone who's shown that for the last 2 years, he or she has been working in QTP and manual testing. When the interview happens, you would realize that only 20% of the time has gone to QTP. Because in your workplace, sometimes there's so many demanding things that you may not be completely dedicated to working on automation. So what that does is it has taken away your exposure from QTP and minimize it to short period. But when you show this off projects, you speak with a lot of confidence. You say that despite the fact, you have this in your overall capability. So this off project experience will work great but people got real-time experience. People have got no resume, no work experience, but still want to put this in. When you talk about keywords, most of them would be possible when you have automation experience. Is it possible to show any manual testing results? So, yeah, I think I focused this session more towards people who got trained on these automation tools and who've been interested to move forward, okay? But the same concepts in terms of keywords can be applied even to manual testing. Talk more about web services, talk about database testing, talk about backend testing, use Scrum, Agile a few times, not one or two places in your resume, keep repeating it. If you've got knowledge for a quality center or a Bugzilla kind of a management tool, use that. So the same concept can apply anywhere. The content can change, okay? One more thing, Dean, that I wanted to put, that I've completely skipped my mind to put it into this presentation is that if you attend webinars like this one, it's a Crank Your Resume webinar. You don't want to take this webinar and put it that I've attended a Crank Your Resume webinar. Why? It says that you attended marketing and this is the output of that webinar. Don't do that. But let's say you attended a one-hour session on, let's say, mobile testing or, you know, the latest in, anything, Selenium testing, anything. Put that in there. For example, even this training program that you've attended, say that you've attended a 200-hour program on automation testing using Selenium and so on. You don't have to put my name, but say that you've gone through a 200-hour program. Why 200 hours? My live class is only 15 hours, right? But live classes were never everything. In total, there are close to about 100 hours of videos on both each QTP and Selenium. And to practice on it itself will take you at least another 100 hours or so. Right? Let's see. Any other things that are there that I can take up as questions? Yeah, if your pressure just finished QA course, perfect. You should try and adapt it to that. The project is very short and the interview is supposed to keep you asking. You worked on some projects for 5 years. It seems that they're not so happy. Yeah, because you show one project and you say that for 5 years you've been doing the same thing. They typically see that you've not been used to change. You've not been exposed to too many different things. And it's not very impactful for the discussion. What's the early target for experiences in the current market? So it varies, but I would say you can start anywhere from $30 to $35, depending on the client location and your expectation, and go up to $65, $70 on the kind of skills you have. You've got a strong exposure to Selenium, and you add mobile testing into it, and let's say a little bit of web services and a little bit of a few other tools into it. You have 5-6 years experience, then you can always command even 55, 60 and plus dollars an hour. Nobody has time. Sharif, I think you should go back and look at the message. The message is very clear. I'm saying, how do you get your resume to at least have it in front of the people? They don't have to go through the entire resume, but they'll go through the keywords. And if they happen to learn your off-project experience, then you've got something on your strength to talk. So how to put off-project experience in somebody? Great idea. So what you do is you put here saying 200 hours of intensive, detailed programming and framework-based training on Selenium automation tool. Put something like that, okay? Attended a 200 hours program. A lot of people will attend a 10-hour program or a 20-hour program. You say 200 hours. Why? Because there's 100 hours of content to watch and there's 100 hours of practice to watch. So you can always easily put 200 hours. And you say that you've done it in a period of about 5-6 months. Yes, Prashant, you can put the experience. That's exactly what I'm saying. How can we list experience if you're moving from developer to testing? So, Akila, that's a good question. Now, if you're moving from a development background to testing, the way you can put it is this. Number one is that you also should be very clear with what is the intent behind moving from development. You should be very clear about explaining that, because that's the first question a lot of people will ask. why are you trying to move from development to testing? Now, lot of these automation tools have got a lot to do with development. So you can put in a word saying that having been exposed to programming and development and the fact that automation testing tools, the best benefit comes when you do the programming behind it. That is the reason that you felt that you will make an impact in that role, and that is the reason you want to approach that. Mock interviews for practice if needed. There's a lot of interview question and answer in the groups. That's something off the topic for now. How to cover if you have break in experience. So if you have break in experience, fill that break. Let's say you have a year's break. Fill that break with that you have attended this program and show this project experience as part of that. Which has 75% merit testing, 25% on same job. Yeah, that's exactly what I mentioned, Ashish, if you remember. That even though if you've been working for 5 years on manual and automation, you may just be doing 25% of your automation. And that's the reason you need to enhance and say that. That is the reason why you invested your time and money into going through this program. Let's see. Do you think we need to run a resume to resume experts on Dice.com? Okay. Good question. I don't have a steady answer for that. I won't say no. I won't say yes. If you've got additional money and if you want to make best use, any advice is good. You just have to implement the right things at the end of the day. Okay. I think once you put this and you show it to someone who's reviewing resumes, they may have very typical thought process that this is the standard way of doing resume. Your resume is looking to be standing out in a different manner. Do not go that route. Put it very standard. Now, my intent is to talk about something which is untraditional, okay? Something which will create better impact, hopefully. And that is experimental, as I told you, Phil. It is my observations, and I strongly believe in it. If you do, then you should apply. But resume experts, I think there's no harm if you can effort. I don't know if I would do it myself. But if I'm really stuck and I need an advice, I will go for it. Can we mention the period of the project? Correct. So, for example, even in this, you can say that let's say project one. Okay. Say that you've spent about 30 hours of effort developing this. Okay. Plan took about 20 hours. Design and build took about 40 hours. Test run and maintenance took about 70 hours. So put that. Why not put 100 hours into this project? Just show them. You know, you've gone into the depth of creating. I must have shown it to you in 5 hours, but you really go into the depth of doing it for lots of test cases, then it will take time, correct? So if not 75 hours, so you should substantiate very realistically. Okay? But it's a good idea. I think it's a good idea to put effort into it and say how many hours you spent doing such a thing. So team, about the training, this is not to promote my training. This is to help people who have attended the training or even people who have not attended to still be able to apply some of these concepts into their resume and find a job. Regarding the training, please write to, go to the website and follow the instructions from there. What are the best job search sites for QTP? I wouldn't say QTP, but technology job sites, I think DICE, Career Builder and Monster are the top. Typically, any of your job requirements might come through them, but you can also put it into your Facebook and LinkedIn profiles. You can use, yes, can I use the gap of unemployment as my off-project experience? Perfect, absolutely. That's a great potential idea for you to put it and say that this is what you've done in that field. I practice a lot and I'm expert in QTP now, but when I look at job opportunities everywhere, they ask about 2 to 5 years of experience. What should I do in that case? So you put that. Let's say you've got about 2 years experience. You put that, but you create a 5-page resume. Someone will think, how does this person have 2 years experience but a 5-page resume? What is there in the resume? When they go in there, that is when they'll start figuring out that there is something more to it. The intent is to try and get their attention towards your strength area, and if these projects that you have gone through in the training are your strength, then get them talking on. Salaries have answered. What if they ask a question about what you have done in previous project, as we have no experience? Then why are you showing it? If you've got no experience, then why are you showing the project? Right? I already have 5 pages of my 12 years. So 12 years, why do you want 5 pages, Abdul? I would suggest that, you know, you got to cut down the last 5 or 6 years of your experience into half a page. And then you would have a 3-page resume and put another 3 pages. See, you take your decision. You find out. I'm not going to spoon feed and tell you exactly what to do. I'm giving you the message. You have to find a way to get it done. But do not keep the first five years of your project experiences at the same level of detail. Reduce it. How can someone improve their interview skill? Yeah. So, says what I'll be doing is I will be organizing another resume following this. I'll communicate on the date where I talk about how to attend and interviews in a very efficient manner. Any advice on cover letter? Take this good summary and put it into English as a couple of paras of message, like an email, and that should be good. Yeah, if you've attended SAP and Informatica training, put it in there. There's nothing wrong. But don't put too many things. I mean, SAP training, if you put SAP into this, then say that the reason you wanted to do SAP training was that you wanted to get into SAP-based testing using QTP. And that's why you did. If you add Informatica, there may be no link with QTP. So identify which is your focus area. Don't say that I'm good in three different areas, like Informatica, SAP, and QTP. Say what's the link between them. Okay, there are about 45, 50 more questions, but I'm almost towards the end of the session. Let's see if I can take a couple of more. As for BS, they ask for QA teams. Same message as earlier team. So you decide how you want to present it. You take what you've mastered in the training and put it in. Team, once again, the information about my training and everything is found on the website. For QTP, you can go to this website. For Selenium, you can go to this website. And for IT Eden, which is still under development, will be the main website from everything will be linked. Software volunteering jobs are rare because there is a lot of effort in trying to bring someone who's got no exposure, no experience, and there will be more of a bottleneck in the team than productive. So volunteering job is kind of a little rare. It is more beneficial to get a real-time job. Not everyone would appreciate for people to come in as freshers and use their project as a launching ground. Because for a project team, the cost is not critical. The time, effort they put and the productivity is important. For a CTO or a CIO or a VP of that department, cost is essential. So there should be a balance between their thoughts. My future training program, everything is part of itelearn.com. I intend to use the next few months to develop a catalog of software testing tutorials on various concepts and tools. This is my plan, and that is the reason I have tried to shy away from some of the live webinars also. Also because live videos have been the most preferred concept. So as things happen, you will get emails on that. Alright team, I think there are a few more, but not necessarily something that I've not directly or indirectly answered. Appreciate you joining. There were over 500 registrations for this webinar. So if you're watching the video, I apologize, I couldn't accommodate each of you into this live webinar. But thank you for watching the video. Thank you for attending the live webinar. All the best, and wish you a great success in your career. Thank you so much, team. Bye.